Rachel Ara right in front of her work. Hi, Rachel.
Hello.
Thank you so much for being with us today. Because of the work that you do and all the background that you have, you were a computer system designer for 25 years before you became an artist. People out there have confirmed you as a non-conformist.
Yes, yes.
I'm really keen to know, is there anything that you feel that you conform to?
That I conform to?
Yeah.
That's a really interesting question. Well, I suppose I conform to the laws of the land and I behave myself in that sense. I mean, we're all different, but in the sense we're all so alike.
Yeah.
That's the difference.
Yeah. Do you always start with a very clear idea of what you're going to achieve, or things change and evolve?
Oh, things change and evolve. I work in a very organic way, and I think because I'm working on no budgets,
yeah.
I'm doing everything myself. It's
yeah.
when you've got an understanding of materials, things change.
Yeah.
But I do everything myself. I do the programming, the welding,
uh-huh.
and I work solely with women as well,
oh.
which I think people find of interest because it's looking at how women are excluded from a lot of the STEM subjects. They're excluded from programming, excluded from engineering, welding.
From art.
From everything.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. For example, this piece was shown in South Korea, and I couldn't ship the back frame because it was too expensive, so I had to find a woman welder
uh-huh.
in Korea. That was very, very difficult.
Uh-huh.
But when I did, I worked beautifully with her. So I sent her the CAD drawings and she built it, and it was perfect, and there was no fuss.
Wow.
Because often when you work with men, it's like, that's a bit tricky, it might cost you a bit more. No nonsense, it was just very direct.
In terms of concept, when you start, like for example, this work that we are sitting in front of, how did this concept come about?
It was looking at the inequality of pay of women. For example, women in the art world will get paid about 80% less than men, which means we're restricted to smaller studios. If you take my studio where there's 500 artists, the women will have the smaller ones. So in a way, we're very limited what we can do. And this piece was very much a kick against being small. I mean, this work doesn't fit in my studio.
Mm-hmm.
I made it in a modular way, so mm-hmm. I can assemble it outside. It's like, well, you're not going to pay me the same, but it's not going to stop me making bigger work.
Mm-hmm.
So it was around values and values of women. But women are priced and sold and traded in prostitution, so that's why I use the neon.
Mm.
So really, the artwork, all it's doing is showing its sales price.
No.
And it's really, I mean, it's criticism of the art market, but we're not looking at the art anymore. We're just looking at the provenance, because there's art as an investment.
Mm.
So we're just looking at the price. If an artist is thought of very highly, then the price will be quite high.
Is this artwork for sale, if somebody wants to buy it?
This is the price in Korean won.
So,
about £250,000.
But the price changes, right?
The price changes in real time. I mean, really, what I do is I have a set of algorithms, programs I call the endorsers, like the endorsers of the art world, and they run it every night, and they look at my social media, they look at my provenance and arrive at a value.
Mm.
And then this value is posted to the Internet of Things. So this artwork will pick up the value, and it will fluctuate during the day, because people don't like static things, so they want to see things move. So it will fluctuate with about a percentage.
Mm.
So if you tweet it, it will automatically go up.
So at the moment that somebody actually wants to buy this, they put an offer, would you give it to them for the price that it is priced at that point?
Yeah, that's fine.
Since you've been doing a lot of shows, in conjunction with museums as against galleries, and you've been doing a lot of solo work, not necessarily a lot of group work with other artists, is that a conscious choice?
No, I think, to be honest, I'm quite new to the art world. I mean, I worked in IT nearly 30 years, and then I trained as a cabinet maker. So I've really only been practicing for 5 years, and I think it's because I'm quite young. So I haven't got that provenance behind me that commercial galleries will want to work with me.
Mm.
I don't have things to sell.
Mm-hmm.
I don't make products, I don't make pictures. I mean, and my work, I like it better in museums because a lot more people see it, and it's about being provocative and starting conversations.
Since we're talking about this work particularly and how it talks about valuing itself,
yes.
If you had to, I mean, in the art world in general, if you had to propose how any artwork should be valued, what would that be?
Well, it should be valued by appreciation, and then by how much it questions. I mean, there's so many different types of art, aren't there? There's aesthetic art, there's commercial art, but art in museums is really meant to be, I guess, at the time, and questioning things at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I value it. And also, you know, so it'd be a bit more even. You know, at the moment you have the mega rich artists and you have the artists without anything. It's like society, it's hyper-capitalist. You have the very rich people and the very poor. Right. They seem to be losing the minimum, medium. Yes, I would like to stir people by provoking them, by poking.